volunteers, the amount of work and energy and resources that goes into putting on these VegFests, it's immense. So it's really an honor to be here and to be speaking with all of you. My name is Colleen Patrick-Goudreau, and the mission and the work I do is to empower people to make informed food choices, to debunk myths about veganism, to be a voice for animals, and to give people the tools and resources they need to live according to their own values of compassion and wellness. I always say that I'm not asking people to live according to my values. I'm urging people to live according to their own values. And I know people want to make this change. The problem is not that people don't know why vegan. The problem is that people don't know how vegan. The problem is that people already know what they want to do. They already know they want to make a change. They just struggle and they have challenges in doing it, right? Despite the fact that so many people want to make this change, so many people have blocks and we make excuses, and there are myths and misconceptions around all of these issues, such that people wind up not doing anything at all, despite the fact that they really want to make a change. So why is that? Why is it with so many compelling reasons to make this change, are people having struggles, and people, why are people challenged with it? I think there are a number of reasons, one of which is we live in a culture that doesn't encourage us to make the most healthful choices, doesn't encourage us to make the most compassionate choices, right? We live in a culture where we're bombarded with the message that we should consume as much meat, dairy, and eggs as possible several times a day. We're bombarded with this information. We're bombarded with these messages through television, through the internet, through radio, through print advertising, name it. We're bombarded. Do your own experiment and see how many times a day we get these messages that we should be consuming as much meat, dairy, and eggs as possible, right? So we live in a culture that doesn't support us making the most healthful choices. We live in a culture that doesn't support us making the most compassionate choices. We live in a world where, in many ways, animal exploitation and abuse is encouraged and looked upon with those who oppose it are looked upon with suspicion. People are kind of suspicious of people who oppose it, right? I mean, one of the things that saddens me most is that we encourage children to be compassionate. We foster this in children, and we're suspicious of compassionate adults. We call it sentimentality, right? We negate it, we minimize it. And I think most of us can identify with that process of going from an innately compassionate child to a desensitized adult. I think most of us can identify with this process. I grew up back east. I grew up eating everything that walked or swam or flew. I was the child who you would have said loved animals, although I don't think you have to love animals in order to not want to hurt them. I don't think you have to be an animal lover to not want to contribute to violence against them. But I was that child. I was the child who certainly never committed any violence against them, was appalled whenever any violence was committed against them, intervened when anything was wrong, even something minor, if it was a stray, you know, stray dogs or stray cats or a bird who had fallen from a tree and needed to be nursed back until she could fly again. You know, these things that we would praise in children. I was a child who, like most children, had images of animals all over my clothing, all over my pajamas, all over my wallpaper, stuffed animals in my bed. I was read books, as most children, all children are, read books that used animals to teach me how to read, how to count, how to spell. The most fundamental skills were taught to me by animals, right? We use Aesop's fables to teach us how to be respectful, social creatures. In every way, I was given the message that animals are an integral part of who I am and my development. And yet, at the same time, I was being fed animals. The very same animals whose images were all over my clothing. The very same animals who I was brought to the petting zoo to admire, right? And when I questioned this, my parents had some pretty lame answers, right? In order to, you know, stay with the status quo. And so eventually, that compassion that was so fierce and so unconditional at one time began to be put to sleep and became dulled, right? And I began to compartmentalize my compassion. And I began to compartmentalize the animals into those who I loved and who were worthy of my love and who I lived with, and to those who were valuable only insofar as they could do something for me, right? However they could provide me with something. And so I went about my life, and that compassion, the good news is that compassion goes to sleep, but it doesn't go away. And the vault that we lock it in is not watertight, it's porous. And so even though I was consuming animals and everything that walked and swam and flew, that compassion kept trying to get out, kept trying to leak through, and it comes out through these justifications and these excuses and these defense mechanisms that we have to keep doing what we're doing, right? So I was that person. And luckily, my journey took me to read some books. I read Diet for New America. I stopped eating land animals, read some more books, stopped eating everything that came out of or off of an animal, became vegan. And interestingly, the response that my parents had was a little different than the response they had when I was a compassionate child. Not so encouraging, not as supportive, right? Where there had been encouragement and support when I was this compassionate child, now there was hostility and defensiveness, right? And yet it was the very same compassion, the very same compassion. The only difference was the recipients of that compassion, right? So I persevered, I'm here today. I mean, this is the story. I think many of us have this kind of journey. But we're taught that we should choose convenience over compassion. We're taught that we should choose the status quo over our own values. And so these are the kinds of things that we're getting all of the time. And these turn into these myths and these misconceptions and these excuses that we use to stop us from becoming awake again. Because there's a lot at stake if we became awake. There's a lot at stake. And so these myths are around nutrition, they're around food, they're around the animals themselves, history, anthropology, and all of these things. These are the things that we tell ourselves to keep doing what we're doing. Nutrition is the biggest one. Most anyone who's ever been vegetarian or vegan knows that the number one question we're asked when we say we're vegan is...
Protein.
You've heard that before. Amazing. Where do you get your protein, right? The question is not where do vegans get their protein. The question is, why have we all been taught that the nutrients we need are animal-based? Why have we all been taught that the nutrients that we need to go through the animal to get to the nutrients that the animals get because they eat plants, right? We're going through the animals to get to the plants that have the nutrients. The nutrients we need are plant-based. That's the bottom line. The nutrients we need are plant-based. The only nutrient we need that is not plant-based is vitamin B12, but it's not animal-based either. It's bacteria-based. It grows on bacteria, B12 does. But the nutrients we need are plant-based, right? And so right now what we're doing is going through the animal, we need to skip the middle animal. And when we skip the middle animal, we skip the saturated fat and the dietary cholesterol and the harmful animal protein and the lactose, right? And we go directly to the source. We get the vitamins and the minerals that we need and the phytochemicals and the antioxidants and the fiber and the folate, right? Because it makes no sense from a health perspective, from an ethical perspective, from a resource perspective, to go through these animals to get these nutrients. I mean, I said that we're taught that the nutrients we need are animal-based. I could quiz you. If I asked you where we're supposed to get calcium, what would you say?
Milk.
Cow's milk specifically. Not milk, not rat's milk. Rat's milk no one cares about. It's cow's milk that we're told we need to get our calcium from, and now goat's milk, we're told, of course, and sheep's milk. And in different parts of the world, it's buffalo milk and camel's milk. If I were to ask you where we're supposed to get our omega-3 fatty acids, you would say, interesting, fish. Heard the same thing I've heard. And if I were to say we're supposed to get our protein, you would say, meat. Flax, what did you say? We'll talk about that later. So eggs, meat, animal products. We're told we're supposed to get our protein from animal products, right? So it's incredibly resource intensive to do this. It doesn't make any sense. It makes a lot of money, but it doesn't make any sense. And if you look at something just like calcium, right? Well, first of all, what's calcium?
Mineral.
Thank you. You're good. She's right in front because she's been paying attention. Calcium is a mineral. And where are minerals found?
Ground.
In the ground, in the earth, in the soil, right? And so why does cow's milk have a lot of calcium in it? Because the cows eat grass. All right, you don't need me. You seem to like know. I'm out of here. So the cows eat grass. They're supposed to be eating grass. 3 out of 4 cows are not eating grass. They're kept on dry lots, and dairy cows in particular. They're kept on dry lots, and they're not eating grass, so they're not getting calcium. And so that the dairy industry can live up to its marketing claims that it's a high-calcium food, what do they do to the feed of the cows? They supplement their feed with calcium. You could supplement your feed with calcium and skip all of this resource-intensive, you know, ness, right? You could supplement. No, you don't have to supplement your feed with calcium. Your feed, your food, with calcium. We could go directly to the source, and we can go to the plants and obviously get calcium this way. But this is what we do. We are breeding animals only to use them up until we kill them, and we're feeding them supplemented food so that we can call it high calcium milk, high calcium food, and we're impregnating these cows who are pregnant for 9 months, almost as long as a human being. And I have to tell you that I remember The day I learned that cows have to be pregnant in order to give milk, produce milk, lactate, right? We're not encouraged to think that. I remember that day, and I remember feeling so stupid. Because I was a young adult, I understood basic biology, and I don't they have to be pregnant. Of course they do. They're mammals, right? But our language doesn't even support that. We say cows give milk, right? We don't say we take their milk. We don't say they lactate. We don't say they produce milk. We say they give milk, as if they come into this world ready to bestow upon us their nutritional gold. Here's my milk for the humans. Be well, right? I mean, that's the message that we get. Because I really honestly see more people afraid of stopping consuming cow's milk than anything else. And there's a fear that has been put in all of us. Fear to stop consuming this milk, right? And yet, what would happen? What would happen? I mean, what's so remarkable when you think about the way this is done and the fact that cows have to be pregnant. And at the end of that 9 months, she has her baby, and all she wants is her baby. That's all she wants. Humans do not have the market on maternal affection. All she wants is her baby. She wants to clean him, she wants to feed him, she wants to nurture him. That's all she wants. But she's not allowed to have her baby because we need to take her baby away so that we can take her milk, right? And if he's male and 50% are, he's killed right away for veal or after 16 weeks. If she's female, she's put in the same servitude as her mother. And then the mother, after she's no longer useful, no longer profitable, at about 5 years old, not at the end of her life, at the end of her productivity, she's sent to slaughter. And I remember when I realized that too, that there is no retirement spa for cows. There's no retirement spa for used up cows, and we all so desperately want to believe there is, because none of us wants to actually contribute to harm. We don't want to contribute to harm, and yet we are without knowing it. And that's what we're contributing to. And so if we were to imagine for a moment, just imagine in your mind's eye that this is a wild cow who was allowed to have her own baby. Because cows were once wild, we domesticated them. They've been here for thousands and thousands of years, and they used to live in the forest, and they used to eat foliage, and they used to eat grass. But imagine for a moment that she's allowed to keep her baby. He would drink from his mother's milk. He would drink his mother's milk, and then what? He would start to grow. He would become weaned. He would move on to solid foods, and he would get his nutrients from the grass, right? Now, we can identify with this somewhat. I know most of us can. We become weaned. We stop drinking our human milk. But then we're told, hang on, don't be hasty. I know you're not consuming your own species milk anymore, but if you want to be healthy, you need to consume the milk of another species. When the offspring of that very species stops drinking his own mother's milk into adulthood, it doesn't make any sense, right? Not only are we the only animal who drinks another animal's milk, we're the only one who drinks it into adulthood. I mean, if I were to just say, forget all the nonsense about consuming another animal's milk, let's just consume our own milk into adulthood. Come on. People are like, oh my God. It's disgusting. Why would I do that? Why would I eat cheese from human milk? Why would I do that? That's disgusting. Our own species milk, and we think it's vile to consume it as adults, right? We've all been sold that it's completely normal to consume the milk of another species, right? Well, why? Why cow's milk? Why goat's milk? Why buffalo milk? Why camel's milk? Is there something so special about this substance that makes it conducive to human consumption? Is there something so special about it? Why cow's milk? Why these animals' milk? What is it that they have in common? These animals, I mean, because honestly, truthfully, if we wanted the highest calcium animal's milk, we would be consuming hyena's milk. Hyena's milk is the highest in calcium. Why aren't we eating? Why not cow hyena's milk?
It's not available.
It's not available. They kill you if you try to consume their milk, if you try to milk them or impregnate them. The difference is that cows and buffalo and cattle, they are herd animals. They're vegetarian animals. They would not try to kill you. They're easy to keep together. They're easy to control. That's how arbitrary it is. It has nothing to do with the nature of the milk. It has everything to do with the nature of the animals. That's how arbitrary it is. And believe me, someone has probably tried to get hyena's milk. They're not with us anymore. So my point is that it's arbitrary, right? So we need to skip the middle animal, go directly to the source. Go to the green leafy vegetables, the bok choy, the kale, the collard greens, the beans, the nuts, all of the foods that are richest in calcium. We're better off for it, we absorb it much better, and the animals are better off for it, right? And you can do this with every nutrient. You can do this with the omega-3 fatty acids. I would ask you, why do fish have omega-3 fatty acids in their flesh? Because they eat the phytoplankton, they eat the algae, right? They're consuming the plants that are rich in omega-3 fatty acids. So when we eat their flesh, if they've consumed these plants, we then may absorb some of their omega-3 fatty acids. In the meantime, we also get the saturated fat, the dietary cholesterol, the animal protein. We get some heavy metals thrown in for good, right? And so we're depleting the ocean of life. We've wiped out salmon in the East Coast. We've pretty much wiped it out in the West Coast. And so what's the alternative, we're told? We'll factory raise them. So we still get all of the things that are harmful, and we're still getting the heavy metals because these are carnivorous fish, so we have to feed them other fish, so we take those fish from the ocean and we put them in these factory farms. And we're adding pesticides and we're adding antibiotics for what? For omega-3 fatty acids that are sourced from plants? So again, we can skip the middle fish and go directly to the flax seeds, to the hemp seeds, to the walnuts. We can go directly to the DHA, which is what our bodies turn these essential fatty acids into anyway. DHA is what our bodies turn these fats into. We can go directly to DHA. I have one on my site that I really highly recommend, and it's sourced from algae, okay? You can do this with protein, right? Protein, everyone's obsessed with protein. Nobody cares about what you're eating until you tell them you're vegan. Everyone's so concerned about your health, and everyone's so concerned and you're making sure you're getting enough protein, right? Nobody knows anything about any amino acids until you tell them that you're vegan. They're so concerned, right? Please raise your hands if you've heard of heart disease. Everybody heard of heart disease? Anybody hear of diabetes or high cholesterol? Anybody know anybody with high cholesterol, high blood pressure? Anybody? Raise your hand if you know someone with kwashi orichor. One hand went. Kwashi orichor? Nobody? You'd think we'd know someone with kwashi orichor, because we're so obsessed with protein deficiency. Kwashi orichor is the scientific term for protein deficiency. We don't have kwashi orichor in developed nations. We don't have kwashi orichor here, right? We're so concerned. We don't have kwashi orichor wards in the hospitals, right? We don't have kwashi orichor specialists. Anybody have kwashi orichor specialists in the house? Quick, I need a kwashi orichor specialist. Someone's dying of protein deficiency, right? We've seen people with kwashi orichor. We've seen late night appeals for hunger organizations. We've seen children with distended bellies and discolored skin. They have kwashi orichor. They're not getting protein. They're not getting protein because they're not getting any food. And the only time we see true kwashi orichor, even in developed nations, is when people aren't eating, when they're anorexic, when they're very sick and they're literally not taking in any food. That's when we see kwashi orichor. But the bottom line is, all those diseases, all those things that I mentioned before, those are diseases of excess. That's what we suffer from. We don't suffer from diseases of deficiency. We took care of rickets. We took care of scurvy, okay? Who's scurvy? Anyone? That's not what our problem is. That's not to say that these nutrients aren't important. Of course they are. The point is that we need to get them from plants. We don't need to get them from animals. Does that make sense? Because I don't even want you to leave here thinking about me and what I say and any. Don't even think about me. I just want it to make sense. Because it's just basic common sense. You do not have to become a nutritionist to understand this. It's not that complicated. The nutrients we need are plant-based, period. And so some of the other excuses we have and blocks we have and misconceptions are around food, right? Which really, I think, have more to do with self-perception, all the stuff around food. One of the things that happens, there's probably a top 10 number of things people say when you tell them you're vegan. One of the other things they do when you tell them you're vegan, you become a confessional, like you're a confessional. Like, so everyone tells you what they eat as soon as you tell them that you're vegan, which is lovely, because I want to have this conversation. And I know that's what it's going to do. So I say I'm vegan wherever I go, just because I know it's going to start the conversation. It's the best conversation to have. So when we say we're vegan, one of the first things people say, sometimes they say, oh, I'm vegan too. Well, I eat fish. And I eat chickens. But I'm vegan. And I know it drives some vegans crazy because fish are not plants. And chickens are not plants. But I think it's really interesting to hear that people want to identify as vegan. That they see something positive in saying I'm vegan. They want to claim that. And I think it's really important to hear that. So you know, there's some desire in them to own that and to put that badge on, but they just need to be told. there's plants and minerals and animals, main kingdoms, and help them put in what fits. Okay, so the other thing that people say when you say I'm vegan is I don't eat a lot of meat, I don't eat a lot of dairy, I don't eat a lot of cheese, I don't eat a lot of eggs, whatever it is they say. I have never met one person who hasn't said, I don't eat a lot of meat, so I don't need to give it up, I don't eat that much, right? Happens the same thing, I tell people I don't have television. They say, yeah, I don't watch a lot of TV. First of all, I didn't ask, so second of all, it's so interesting because people have this perception of themselves and then there's the truth. The bottom line is you don't know how much you eat until you stop. You don't know how much you do of anything until you stop because you're not aware of your habits. And all of the things we eat, every choice we make, the way we plate our food, the choices, everything is a habit. All of our food choices are habits. They're familial habits, they're cultural habits, they're personal habits, but they're just habits. And that's the good news, and it's the bad news. It's the bad news because we are fierce creatures of habit, but it's the good news because habits are meant to be broken. So what's happening is when you decide to not consume animals or animal products, right, especially doing something like my 30-day vegan challenge. So my 30-day vegan challenge says just stop for 30 days. Just stop long enough to just be aware of your habits, train some old habits, create some new habits. So what happens is someone goes, okay, well, I want a burger. Wait, I'm not eating burger right now. So what am I going to choose? What's over here? And you start to look at things that you never saw before. You start to see things you never saw before, restaurants and cuisines and foods and ingredients that you never noticed before. It's not that you didn't have them or couldn't have them because you weren't vegetarian or vegan. It's that you weren't looking in that direction. So when people say, who are not vegetarian or vegan and say, I could never do that, it seems so hard. Once you start looking, that's when you see it. But you have to stop it long enough to recognize it. And so what happens is you go from looking in this direction your whole life to looking in this direction. And where people get stuck is in this in-between. They get stuck in the transition because we are fierce creatures of habit. And so, honestly, I mean, the 30-day vegan challenge is all about that. I hold your hand and answer all of these questions because I think a lot of people who have struggle, especially people who said they were vegetarian or vegan and then stopped, I think it's because they removed a foundation that was familiar and didn't replace it with another foundation. So they're on this shaky ground and they don't have anything else they're standing on. The point is, by the time you get over here, this becomes second nature and these become your habits, right? Make sense? So, another thing people say, speaking of nature, is they say, well, I tried being vegetarian, tried being vegan, but I just craved meat. Anybody ever hear that? I just really, or say that, you don't have to raise your hand. I know you said it, I hear you. I know, I've been there, I'm sure I said it myself, right? I tried being vegetarian, but I really, really craved meat. It's not gonna work, I don't take any good pictures when I'm speaking. I just don't, it's just fact. So I can give you a picture later, okay. They're just horrible. I'm just animated and they're the most embarrassing photos. So luckily no one's putting them up online. So people say, I tried being vegetarian, but I just craved meat. And I said, you weren't craving meat. And they said, no, I really was. I was craving meat and I had a burger and I felt really good. And I said, you weren't craving meat. We are not obligate carnivores. We do not crave the flesh of other animals. We are not lions on the Serengeti who, when a gazelle runs by, we run after the gazelle and try to take the gazelle down with our bare hands. We can't do it, and we don't want to do it. We don't want to see the blood. We don't want to see the gore, right? That's not what we want. If you want to know what it's like to crave the flesh of another animal, imagine what a domestic cat looks like when they see a bird. Do you ever see a domestic cat see a mouse or a bird? They get really focused, and their eyes dilate. And their tail starts to flicker, and their teeth starts to chatter, and they make this funny little sound, and they might drool a little bit. Is that how you get when you see a bird fly overhead, or when you see cows grazing, or deer grazing, or squirrels scurry past you? I've never seen anybody do that. I'm going to guess, safe guess, that you don't get like that. If you do, we have some help. You can see us afterwards. The point is, that's not how we respond when we see live animals. We're not obligate carnivores. That's not even how we respond if we see animals who've been hit by a car on the side of the road. The first thing we think is disgust, and the second thing we think is compassion. We hope they weren't hurt. We hope they didn't suffer. Right? We don't take out our forks and start thinking about lunch. That's not what we do. So we don't crave the flesh of another animal, but we do crave fat, and we crave salt, and we crave flavor, and we crave texture, and we crave familiarity, and all of these things are available in plant foods. I didn't mean that as a gesture in any way. All of these are in plant foods, okay? The problem is that we were taught the source of these cravings, meat, dairy, and eggs, the source of the fat and the salt, and the texture and the chewiness, before we were taught the cravings themselves. So what we need to do is just, it's a shift in our way of thinking. It's a shift in our way of thinking. We need to say, okay, what is it that I'm craving? I'm craving a burger. No, I'm not. It's fat, it's salt, there might be a chewiness. Okay, where can I go to get that? Instead of going to what we're just taught and used to, saying, okay, it's fat, it's salt. Okay, I can have avocado, I can have guacamole, I can make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, I can have some nuts, I can have some seeds, I could have almond butter, right? When it's salt, you have salt, it's a little salt, very simple, right? Salt. People say, I can never give up bacon, I love bacon so much. Bacon is all about fat and salt and smoke. Pigs don't taste salty and smoky. And I know, because I've kissed my share of pigs. They don't taste that way until you cure their flesh. If you cured my flesh, I would taste pretty salty and smoky too, okay? That's what it's about. It's about curing it so that it tastes smoky. So you can use chipotles, you can use chipotle peppers, and you can use liquid smoke, right? And get that smokiness to make your own bacon out of eggplant or tempeh or tofu or whatever it is. It's the smokiness. It's not the pigs, okay? So that's what I suggest, that you consider what the craving is, and you meet that craving with plant foods. And I use that word craving very loosely. I just want to make it clear that it's not some physiological, you know, it's desire is really what it is. Because we don't crave things we've never had before. I was just in Mexico, I didn't crave any iguana, right? We don't crave things we've never eaten before. We crave the things that we've had, and we crave the things that are still in our bodies. So if we're so used to having all of this fat and salt through animal products, when we get them out of our system, and 30 days is a good time to do it, we stop craving as much, and you start craving whole foods, and you start craving fresher foods. Believe me, I did not grow up eating kale. Not at all. I grew up eating overboiled Brussels sprouts, right? And I didn't even like Brussels sprouts, I don't know why I said that, but overboiled, every vegetable is overboiled and just covered in cream sauces and butters, right? You develop a sensitivity. Our palates are not sensitive when they're coated in fat and salt. So you have to give it time to get that out of your system. Okay, they frying up over there, frying up some tempeh bacon. So that's the idea with cravings. Another thing that happens is people say, well, I could give up everything, but I could never give up X. Took my punchline. I could give up everything, but I could never give up cheese, is usually what people say. So one of my days in the 30-day vegan challenge is called, There Is Life After Cheese, right? So they say, but then I say, well, what do you eat now? And they say, well, everything. I said, I'm sorry. You said you could give up everything, but you can't give up cheese. Why don't you give up everything except cheese? The idea that you won't do enough, you know, you won't do anything because you think you have to do everything doesn't make any sense. The idea that we don't do anything at all because we think we have to do it all makes no sense. Don't do nothing because you can't do everything. Do something, anything. Any step you take will bring you closer to the person you want to be and closer to the animals you want to help. But to do nothing at all because you think you have to do everything is incredibly self-defeatist. And we do this all the time. We defeat ourselves. We're the ones who are defeating ourselves. Right? People say, well, I could be vegetarian, I could be vegan, but I have to chop all these vegetables. And they start whining about chopping vegetables. Oh, time is so busy, I have to chop. Right? It's just unbelievable. This block. Right? It's so busy, I'm so busy, I don't have time. If you have time to get into a car and drive to a restaurant and look for a parking spot and wait for a table and decide what to order and wait for the food and eat the food and wait for the check and pay the check and drive back home again, you have time to chop some vegetables, okay? It's not that we don't have time, it's that we're not using the time we have to chop some vegetables. We're making the choice all the time what to do with our time, right? We're making the choice. We're not, you know, slaves. I know we're busy, I know busy, okay? I get it. But we're not using the time we have. It's not that we don't have the time. We're making choices all the time. But then we have these blocks, right? We get really excited about eating differently and eating vegan, and we come home from the grocery store or the farmer's market, and we put everything in the refrigerator, and we get really excited, and we put all the fruits and vegetables in, and then it comes time to eat, and we go to the refrigerator, and we open the refrigerator, and we see the carrots with their tops on, and the broccoli is still in a bunch, and the cauliflower is still in a head. It'll take forever to chop these vegetables. And we close the refrigerator and we call the pizza guy and then we wait for the pizza. Apparently we have some time. okay? So what I recommend is instead of putting all of the vegetables into the refrigerator when we get home, take a few minutes to chop them, take a few minutes to take the carrots off, the tops off the carrots, and cut the broccoli and the cauliflower into florets. It takes no time, 15 minutes. 15 minutes, get your cutting board out, get a good cutting board, a good knife, because it makes it a lot more pleasurable, it does. If you don't have a good knife and a good cutting board, you're not gonna wanna do it. And so then you don't do it, and then you complain a few times. You're just making scapegoat out of time, right? So get a good cutting board, get a good knife, chop them. If you're following a recipe, and it calls for one onion, chop two onions. You have the cutting board out already. Put one in your recipe, and put one in the refrigerator. If you're able to, get some vegetables that are chopped in advance at the grocery store. Many grocery stores these days are chopping the vegetables in advance. We're always making the decision if we want to spend time or money. So it's going to cost a little bit more, but maybe there's some times you go, you know what, I still want to get really good food into my body, so I'm willing to spend a little bit more so I can do that this week. Next week I'll chop some myself, but this week, darn it, I'm going to get the ones that are chopped in advance. But then people go, but I heard that if you put vegetables that are already chopped in advance into the refrigerator, you're losing some nutrients, they say. I'm concerned I'm losing nutrients. And I say, well, how many vegetables are you eating now? And they say, well, not so many. I say, okay, here's a tip. Vegetables chopped in advance are more nutritious than no vegetables. So brilliant, brilliant, okay? So again, it's just these excuses. We're defeating ourselves all the time. It's not just society. It's not just the government. It's not just the industries that are bombarding us with these messages. We're sabotaging ourselves. People who really want to make this change, we're sabotaging ourselves. I hear people who say that they would love to be vegan, but they don't want to call attention to themselves. They don't want to call themselves out. They don't want to appear different, right? And it's very interesting because we live in a country where we say that we really value individuality, but I don't really think we do. I think we value conformity a lot more. Nonconformist is a dirty word in most people's vocabulary. And yet, everybody says they want to make a difference. Everybody says they want to affect change. They want to do something meaningful. They want to live a meaningful life. And I believe people when they say these things, but I wonder if all of these things mean as much to them as not appearing different. Everybody says they want to make a difference, but I think we forget that in order to make a difference, we may have to do something different. It's only people who step out of their comfort zone and step up and exert their own individuality that have an impact, that do make a difference. It's easy to go along with the status quo, but the question we have to ask ourselves is at what cost? At the cost of our own health? At the cost of our own values? Those are high costs, in my opinion, right? And then there's the people who say, well, I would be vegan, but I don't want to make anybody uncomfortable, so I'm just vegan at home, but when I eat out, when I go to restaurants with friends, when I go to people's houses, or eat with coworkers, I don't want to make anybody uncomfortable, so I just eat. I just eat whatever. And it sounds really noble, doesn't it? It sounds so noble. How noble of you, that you really don't want to consume animals or animal products, but for other people's sake, you're doing it. How kind. How martyrish is that? I'm so suspicious of that, because I actually think it's really an excuse that people use. Who really do know that it's the right thing to do, that they're compelled to do it, but they couch it in the guise of selflessness. And I actually think it's incredibly selfish to say that, because the truth is, how do I know how someone's gonna react? People aren't thinking about me that much, right? I'm gonna show up and try to kind of couch this in a way that's gonna not make someone uncomfortable, apologizing because I don't eat animals because I think it might make them uncomfortable. How do I know? How do I know how they're gonna respond? The truth is, I've never seen people at their most beautiful than when I say my favorite words, I'm vegan, and they say, I've been thinking about going vegan. I have all these questions, I've heard all these myths, I'm not sure about things, can you help me? Or, I love animals, I don't want to hurt them, I'm afraid I won't be able to do it, I travel all the time, did this happen to you, can you help me? Or, I'm cooking more vegan food and I'd love to cook for you, can I have you over for dinner, right? That's their choice. And I always appreciate it, right? But I think we do not give people the benefit of the doubt. I think we underestimate friends and family. And the truth is, as long as we think we're protecting them from some discomfort, we're not only denying our own ethics and perpetuating violence against animals, we're also potentially denying someone else their own transformation. Because how else does it occur except through this honest and open interaction and communication with one another? And what a mess I would be if my behavior were continually determined by how it would make another person react. In other words, if my being vegan does make someone uncomfortable, that's not mine. I didn't set out to make them uncomfortable, but this is who I am. Everyone who meets me knows where I stand on certain issues, namely that animals are here for their own sake and not here for my pleasure. That's not something I have to apologize for. That's not something that changes according to who invites me to dinner and who it might make uncomfortable. So the bottom line is we need to speak our truth without being attached to how that truth will affect another person. Because we underestimate each other, we underestimate ourselves. We play small, we let fear guide us, and the lies we're told become the lies we tell ourselves. One of the things you hear all the time is people say, well, people aren't going to change. It's too hard. People aren't going to stop eating animals. You can't expect that of them. It's too hard to change. Now, I know this sounds crazy, and you can call me crazy because I know it sounds crazy, but I have more faith in people than that. I know people change. I see it every single day. And when we raise the bar and give people the information that they need to make conscious, compassionate choices, we do see people change. We see them make amazing changes. The problem is the more you keep telling people that it's too hard to change, the more they're going to believe you. The more we keep telling people that there's something radical about eating fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds and beans and mushrooms and herbs and spices, it's radical. It's crazy. The more we keep telling people that there's something extreme about not consuming the mutilated bodies and stolen secretions of non-human animals, the more we keep telling ourselves these things, the less we'll expect of ourselves and the less we'll expect of others, and nothing will change. But if we raise the bar and have some expectations of one another, we see amazing things take place that enable people to make the difference they say they want to make. And that's ultimately the question that people ask me, is do I really think people can make a difference? Do I really think people can make a difference? My answer is no. I do not think people can make a difference. I know people do make a difference. Everything we do, everything we buy, everything we eat has an impact on someone or something else. We don't get to decide whether we can make a difference or not. We get to decide only if the difference we inevitably make is negative or positive. That's it. Those are our only two choices. There are no neutral actions. And so for me, being vegan is about living my life with integrity and compassion and doing everything I can to not contribute to violence against someone. Every day I wake up with a palpable feeling of peace, knowing that I am making a nonviolent contribution in this world. That is to say, whereas violence creates more violence, nonviolence also creates more nonviolence. And I like being on that side of the equation. So all I ask is that we remain open. Never say never. Embrace the journey that encourages us to learn new things and try new things and become better people and make more compassionate choices once we know better. Because what I know for sure is that the problems we have in this world are not because we have so much compassion we don't know what to do with it. The problems we have in this world are because people are not living according to their own values of compassion and kindness. It's one thing to say that we're against cruelty and violence. Most of us are. It's one thing to say that we're kind, compassionate people. Most people think they are. It's quite another to manifest those values in our behavior. And so that's my hope. My hope is that we each reflect in our daily choices our deepest values and know that with each bite we take, we have the power to create the compassionate world we all desire. And may it be so. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you so much.